Good afternoon. You're watching Nine News Now. I'm Belinda Russell. We begin. A former top cop, Carrie Jubelin, has today been charged with four counts of unlawfully recording people during his investigations into the disappearance of toddler William Tyrrell. Tiffany Genders has more.
The development in this case comes 3 weeks before the veteran homicide detective will retire from the police force. Gary Jubelin joined the ranks 34 years ago, and today he was visited by his own colleagues and handed a court attendance notice. He's facing four charges, accused of unlawfully recording persons of interest during the investigation into the disappearance of William Tyrrell. The detective chief inspector was the lead on this case until he was sensationally removed when an investigation was launched 5 months ago. Gary Jubelin has hired high-profile barrister Margaret Kinnean SC. In a statement, she says Mr. Jubelin denies any wrongdoing whatsoever and will strongly defend the charges against him. Whatever the outcome of this case, Detective Jubelin has some big supporters in his camp, including family members of homicide victims and those who have worked closely with him on the William Tyrrell case.
A decent, honest bloke. Professionally, his work ethic is beyond reproach, and with his colleagues he wouldn't ask anybody to do anything he wouldn't do himself.
I've just found him to be a superb police officer. He's dedicated. He wants to find William. I mean, this is a really good police officer.
Gary Jubelin is still employed by the New South Wales Police Force ahead of his retirement. These charges will be mentioned for the first time in court at the end of July.
Controversial rugby star Israel Folau has launched a crowdfunding campaign to help him take his former employers to court. Last month, Rugby Australia tore up the 30-year-old's contract when an independent code of conduct hearing found him guilty of breaching the agreement. The former Wallaby, sacked over a homophobic social media post, is now pleading with the public to help him fund his costly legal battle. He's already raised more than $290,000 of his $3 million target. A Melbourne car salesman will remain behind bars until at least September after his arrest by counter-terrorism police. Lana Murphy reports.
Well, this is where Khaled Temsar was arrested yesterday as he attempted to walk into the Somerton Road car dealership and begin his day at work. Instead, officers from ASIO, the AFP and VicPol swooped on the car park, charging him with undertaking preparations to travel overseas and engage in hostile activity. The 29-year-old's office and car were searched by counter-terror police in Roxburgh Park around 8:30 before he was taken away for questioning. It's understood they'd been tracking the car salesman for a number of weeks and that he'd recently returned from a trip overseas. It's alleged he engaged in the preparations between the 3rd and 20th of June. The devout Muslim regularly posted online asking for prayers for Syrian orphans, sick children and persecuted people.
Don't miss out to give for the sake of Allah.
His colleagues say he regularly spoke out against violence and prayed 5 times a day, attending a local mosque on Fridays, and that their co-worker of 3 years was always friendly, charitable and warm.
We're honoured by Allah that he's chosen us to look after him and chosen you, beautiful brothers and sisters.
Police spent the afternoon questioning Tesmar but didn't charge him until around 7 o'clock last night. He was expected to appear at the magistrate's court today, but unbeknown to his lawyer, he actually appeared and was remanded in custody last night, and he'll next appear before a magistrate on September 26.
The mother of a newborn baby found dead in the backyard of a Newcastle home has been found at Penrith in Sydney's west. After speaking with the 18-year-old woman, police have ruled out the involvement of a third party in the baby's death. Results of a post-mortem examination and further forensic testing are still underway. Olympic kayaker Nathan Bagley is behind bars, accused of attempting to smuggle cocaine into Australia. The dual silver medalist appeared in a Brisbane court after federal police raided his Byron Bay home yesterday. The 43-year-old didn't make an application for bail. His younger brother, Drew Bagley, and a co-accused, Anthony Draper, were arrested after a sea chase off the New South Wales north coast last July. Anthony Albanese has softened his stance on the government's tax cut plan, indicating he's open to the idea of backing the $158 billion package in full. Let's go to political reporter Jonathan Kersley. Good afternoon, Jono. He's not ruling anything in or out.
No, he's not. Good afternoon, Belinda. Good afternoon to everybody else. The Labor leader doesn't want to endorse the entire package yet, but likewise, he doesn't want to be seen as holding back the first round of cuts, which are due from July the 1st. Given the government campaigned heavily and almost solely on its $158 billion package, some in Labor are asking the question, if the income tax cuts pass the parliament, what's the government got left? There is a split in Labor's ranks over whether to back the government's tax cuts proposals in full. Backbencher Peter Khalil says the party should, and the shadow cabinet has been summoned for a meeting on Monday. Unsurprisingly, Mr. Khalil's comments have attracted praise from Deputy Prime Minister Michael McCormack and now Finance Minister Matthias Cormann, who says the rest of the party should follow Mr. Khalil. Not just yet, though, says the new Labor leader. Here's Anthony Albanese, followed by Matthias Cormann.
So are you ruling out that you will back these tax cuts in full?
No, we're considering it. But one of the things that we're waiting for, as well as for the government to give us the information that we've requested, they don't have a blank cheque.
And I can't see why Anthony Albanese would allow himself to be tied down to a losing pre-election agenda that the Australian people rejected.
That's the government's chief negotiator in the Senate, Matthias Cormann, there with a little bit of political cheek. This morning, though, there were others showing far more cheek in Canberra, braving the below-freezing conditions for a new dip in Lake Burley Griffin. It was all to mark the shortest day of the year, and in those conditions, Belinda, you'd want it to be the shortest swim of the year too, wouldn't you?
Yes, definitely. Okay, John, we'll have to leave it there. Thank you so much. Apartment owners of the cracking Mascot Towers in Sydney have agreed to pay $1.1 million for urgent repairs after a tense four-hour meeting with engineers last night. Residents heard it's likely they'll be out of their homes for at least another month.
There was no choice, really. We have to do something, otherwise nothing gets done.
The state government has been criticised for not having a representative at the meeting. HMAS Newcastle has received a warm welcome when it sailed into Sydney Harbour for the final time before it is decommissioned. The ship has served the Royal Australian Navy for the past 25 years and was most recently deployed for peacekeeping operations in the Pacific. The frigate will be decommissioned at Garden Island at the end of the month. The original Mr. Movies, Bill Collins, has died aged 84. The legendary film reviewer and TV presenter passed away in his sleep yesterday. Collins, who was born in Sydney's Sutherland Shire, introduced generations of Australians to the world of movies long before streaming services or even DVDs. He hosted a movie review show on Channel 9 from 1969 until 1974. Later in the bulletin, our showbiz reporter will have more on how the entertainment world is reacting to his death.